Welcome everyone to today's webinar, The Association Between Nurse Shift Patterns and Nurse-Nurse and Nurse-Physician Collaboration in Acute Care Hospital Units, sponsored by Krona. I am Aliyah Pavala with Becker's Hospital Review. We will begin today's webinar with a presentation and we'll have time at the end of the hour for a question and answer session. You can submit any questions you have throughout the webinar by typing them into your control panel in the space labeled Enter a Question for Staff and clicking Send. We are looking forward to hearing your questions. Today's session is being recorded and will be available after the event. In about a week following the webinar, we will be sending all registrants a copy of the presentation to the email you used to register. Please be patient as the post-webinar preparation of materials can take some time. At this time, it is now my pleasure to start today's webinar by introducing our presenters. Dr. Amy Witkowski-Simpel is the Assistant Professor at NYU Rory Myers College of Nursing and the Deputy Director of the NIOSH-funded T42 Doctoral Training Program in Occupational and Environmental Health Nursing. Dr. Witkowski-Simpel's research explores how to optimize nurses' work environment to improve nurse well-being, such as burnout, and clinical outcomes, such as patient safety. Her scholarship draws from the theories and methods used in health services research, occupational health and safety, sleep, chronobiology, and nursing. Dr. Witkowski-Simpel's research has been funded by the National Council of State Boards of Nursing, the American Nurses Foundation, and others, and has been published in leading health policy and nursing journals such as Health Affairs, Health Services Research, and the International Journal of Nursing Studies. She graduated from Villanova University with a BSN and holds an MS and PhD from the University of Pennsylvania. Our next speaker, Dr. Shendran Ma, is an assistant professor on the tenure track and health services researcher at New York University Rory Myers College of Nursing. Her program of research focuses on identifying modifiable organizational and individual factors that optimize nursing care and patient outcomes across care settings, from hospital to home health care, especially among older adults. Dr. Ma's research utilizes theories and methodologies from different disciplines, including, but not limited to, sociology, statistics, medicine, public health, and nursing. Prior to joining NYU, Dr. Ma was a postdoctoral fellow in the National Database of Nursing Quality Indicators at the University of Kansas. Dr. Ma completed her PhD at the Center for Health Outcomes and Policy Research at the University of Pennsylvania. Courtney Green is part of the Kronos for Healthcare team, serving as regional nurse executive and healthcare clinical strategist. Courtney has over 15 years of experience in nursing and clinical operations leadership. Her background includes leading and managing change in a variety of operational areas, including nursing operations, centralized staffing, observation, dialysis, wound care, hyperbaric therapies, general medicine, neuro, surgical oncology, and infusion. As a previous director of nursing operations, Courtney understands large project rollouts, as well as she also has experience with site and system-wide implementations of Kronos solutions for healthcare. At this time, I am pleased to turn the floor over to Courtney to begin today's presentation.
Thank you, Aliyah. As Aliyah mentioned, I'm Courtney Green, a regional nurse executive at Kronos. I'd like to welcome everyone to the webinar, The Association Between Nurse Shift Patterns, Nurse-to-Nurse and Nurse-Physician Collaboration in Acute Care Hospital Units. We are excited about this webinar and we hope that you all are too. We read about Dr. Simpel and Dr. Mall's research and thought it was very interesting and should be shared within the healthcare community. Collaboration among healthcare teams is paramount to any healthcare organization and to their patients. In this webinar, Dr. Ma and Dr. Simpel will walk us through their research related to nurse collaboration, shift patterns, and overtime. We hope at the end of the webinar, you will be able to take away key information and apply it to improve collaboration among healthcare teams at your organization. Now I'd like to hand it over to Dr. Simpel and Dr. Ma to present their research.
Thank you so much, Courtney and Aaliyah. This is Dr. Rakowski Stimple. I'm going to start off the webinar. I don't think we need to repeat our title again, but before we move forward, I just want to set up our acknowledgments and also let you know that we don't have any conflicts of interest to report. So as our title does suggest, we are interested in talking about RN work patterns, collaboration, and also patient care and how these three concepts intersect. So first, I'd like to give a little bit of an overview, very briefly, about current trends in the RN work patterns in the hospital setting, as well as an operational definition of collaboration, and then we'll weave in the links to patient safety as we move along the webinar. So for many of you, this might be a review or common sense, but we first wanted to talk a little bit about what the trends are in hospital nurses' work patterns, beginning with shift length and then moving into overtime and some other trends. So as many of you may know, the 12-hour shift came into vogue over 20 years ago and has really taken root as the dominant shift pattern in hospitals. And we know from previous research that current cohorts of nurses really report mostly favorable opinions of this shift schedule. It allows nurses to work 3 days a week instead of five, so it really compresses the work week. It means that there's less time to commute, and there's potentially more time for continuing education and family and social activities. We also note that shift overruns are common when nurses have to stay beyond the end of their scheduled shift. And oftentimes this is to complete additional documentation in the EMR for emergent patient issues or a late discharge or admission, or also for staffing issues if a nurse has to stay until the replacement arrives. So that can really extend an already long 12 or 12 and a half hour shift into 13 or 14 or more hours. And that kind of leads into our next trend around voluntary and mandatory overtime. So there are over a dozen states, about 18 states currently, that have laws that prohibit mandatory overtime. And there's some evidence to suggest that this does reduce mandatory overtime amounts. However, there's nothing around voluntary overtime. And so the line is often blurred between what is mandatory overtime, what's voluntary, what's coercive, what's not. And so there still is quite a bit of variation in how much overtime is used among institutions, with some that are very well resourced and tend not to have very much overtime, to institutions that really rely on it a lot for staffing vacancies and other issues. And finally, we want to note that we know nursing at the bedside is a 24/7, 365 job. So that means that there is always going to be night shift work for some nurses, and there's always going to be rotating shift patterns for some nurses. So what? So what does this mean? So putting some of these work patterns into perspective, I like to think about it this way. So the traditional night shift schedule for a hospital-based nurse is typically two or three consecutive shifts of 12 hours in length from 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. roughly, followed by 2 to 5 days off. And this type of work schedule to non-work days is equivalent to the jet lag that results from undergoing Tokyo to San Francisco round trip every few days. So when you think about it that way, that sounds pretty difficult, pretty harsh. And given the increased acuity of patients that we're seeing in the hospitals these days, the increasingly complex care that they require, increasing demands from technology and other sources and other factors, it's quite understandable that expecting nurses to function at peak performance, given these scheduling patterns, can be quite a challenge. And indeed, we do know from many years of research that nurses that work extended hours and a lot of overtime and lots of consecutive shifts, that there is a detriment to patient care quality. So now I want to move a little bit into collaboration before we link these pieces together. And as noted in the introduction, collaboration is crucial to patient quality care and to patient safety. And for our work, we have used the definition of collaboration as an interactional process in which different parties in the team share objectives, responsibility, decision-making, and power in order to accomplish team goals. And a team is typically a small number of people with complementary skills that are committed to a common purpose for which they hold themselves mutually accountable. So you can see how in the healthcare setting that this is inherently something that's interdisciplinary across care providers and clinicians coming together for that common purpose to provide excellent patient care. And collaboration has really been highlighted since the Affordable Care Act in 2010 to be a critical approach in ensuring optimal quality of care for patients. And it was also referenced heavily in the IOM's milestone report, The Future of Nursing, Leading Change, Advancing Health, with collaboration between nurses and other healthcare providers being emphasized as an essential strategy to improve patient-centered care. So we used our conceptual framework to help us put these pieces together in a way that we could hypothesize how they were interacting. And we used Lee's impaired sleep model, which posits that sleep loss can be caused by one of two events, by sleep deprivation or by sleep disruption or fragmentation. And when we have impaired sleep, that results in impairment to our emotional, our social, and cognitive processing. And so we are thinking that shift work and work stress and overtime obviously can all lead to sleep loss for nurses, which then ultimately leads to difficulties with collaboration due to those factors of our impaired processing. And I think this is pretty easy for most people to relate to. So if you've gotten a poor night's sleep due to having a small child at home, like I do, waking up frequently at night, or if you're staying up late to finish a work project, or perhaps as a student, you were staying up late and cramming for an exam, the next day, how do you feel? Most people don't feel like they're at their best. You might be more cranky or grumpy, less empathetic, less able to tolerate with stressful situations. And so when we think about that transferring into the healthcare setting, being able to work well with others, communicate clearly about a patient's needs, being able to react appropriately, that's how we were thinking that those factors could lead to impairments in collaboration and potentially impact patient care, both patient safety and quality. So Dr. Ma and I got together to do this study, and the purpose of our study was to examine the impact of nurse shift patterns on nurses' collaboration with nurses and physicians in U.S. acute care hospital units using the RN survey from the National Database of Nursing Quality Indicators, or NDINQI. So again, many of you may be familiar with the NDINQI program, but for those of you who are not, the NDNQI is in over 2,000 U.S. hospitals and health systems, so that's about a third of all hospitals, including the majority of magnet hospitals, which are designated as nursing excellence. And those who participate in the NDNQI are nurses at the unit level, and they respond to surveys which measure nursing quality, they help improve nurse engagement, strengthen the nursing work environment, assess staffing, and improve reimbursement for under current pay-for-performance policies. And so nursing-sensitive structure, process, and outcome measures are monitored for the relationship between quality indicators and outcomes. So this is the data set that we are using to try and understand our research questions around collaboration and shift work patterns. So now I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Ma to talk a little bit more specifically about our research methods and our results. And then I will come back and chat with you a little bit more about some discussion and our implications for frontline staff and managers. And then we'll have, again, plenty of time for questions and answers from those attending the webinar.
Thanks, Dr. Witkowski-Stingle, for the nice introduction. So in the following about 10 to 15 minutes, I will share with you more information about the research methods and the results of this study. So to approach our aim, we used the responses from over 24,000 nurses in the NDNQI RN survey data. And for those nurses, they were the staff nurses providing direct care to patients, and they had been on their unit for at least 3 months. In other words, they are the great informants to telling us the work conditions on their unit, including the work collaboration and the unit shift. Also, I want to point out in this study, we conceptualized collaboration and a nurse shift as a unit level organizational behavior. So in our analysis, we conducted at a unit level and included 957 adult units from 168 hospitals. So when it comes to measurement, for collaboration, we measured it from two perspectives, and the nurse shift was indicated in four ways. So more specifically, nurse-nurse collaboration were measured by the nurse-nurse interaction scale, which included sample questions such as nursing staff in pitching and help each other when things get in a rush. And for the collaboration between nurses and physicians, we used nurse-physician interaction scale. And example items included such as there is a lot of teamwork between nurses and the doctors on our unit. So both of these two scales were 6-item Likert scale with response options from strongly disagree to strongly agree. And for the nurse shift measures, we calculated nurse shift length and overtime in hours. We also calculated proportion of nurses worked overtime on a unit, as well as proportion of nurses perceived an increase in overtime on a unit over the past year. We use different indicators just to give us a more complete picture of the nurse shift patterns on units. And you may already notice that these measures were aggregated from nurse responses. So to ensure the aggregated measures were reliable, we only included adult units that had at least 5 nurse respondents and also a respond rate of at least 50%, which means at least half of the nurses responded and at least 5 nurses on a unit. So when in our analysis, we employed a variety of statistical techniques for data analysis, including the standard descriptive statistics, variance analysis, and finally, the multi-level linear regression. In the final analysis, we consider the influence of unit and hospital characteristics, and therefore include a set of covariance, such as starting level, patient to nurse ratio, or unit type, or hospital ownership, et cetera. And also we adjust for the clustering of units within hospitals, just to make sure our analysis was as rigorous as possible. So then what our data tells us, right? That's the most exciting moment to see. But first, I want to show you the characteristics of those nurse respondents because they are the information provider. So here you can see the nurses were about 38 years old with a nursing tenure of about 10 years, and majority of them, 68% of them actually, had a BSN, had a baccalaureate degree in nursing. And on the left side, you can see from this figure is the distribution of nurses in terms of their working unit. So about 1 in 4 of the nurses in our example worked on a critical care unit or a medical surgical care unit. And these nurse respondents were from 168 hospitals. So here, this figure shows the characteristics of these 168 hospitals. So for majority of them, they were non-profit with a bed less than 300 beds and a non-magnet. Roughly about half of them were teaching hospitals. We also want to share with you some information about the characteristics of the study unit. So for these 957 units, they had a nurse staffing level of about 5 patients per nurse. And the figure on the left side shows you unit by the distribution of units by type, as well as, you know, for each type, what's the proportion of unit for this. And as we mentioned early, collaboration is one of the main variables we are interested in. So this figure presents the unit levels of collaboration overall, as well as by unit type. So in general, you will see that nurse collaboration among nurses over is better than collaborations between nurses and physicians. And also we noticed some slight variance across unit types. For here, you can see step down units scored highest on the nurse-nurse collaboration scale, which was 4.63 out of 6. And for critical care unit, for critical care unit and medical unit, they scored highest on the nurse and physician collaboration scale, which both have had a score of 4.17 out of 6. So how about the nurse shift, right? So here this table tells you the nurse shift patterns on units according to the 4 indicators we use. So on average, unit had a shift length of 12 hours and also had an average overtime of 0.37 hours. What that means? That is about 22 minutes overtime. And with the surgical unit had the highest overtime of about 28 minutes. And about 1 in 3 nurses on a unit ended their last shift working overtime than originally scheduled. And also similarly, about 1 in 3 nurses perceived an increase in overtime on their unit in the past year. So this is our final table for the results section, and it shows our estimates of the relationship between collaboration and the nurse shift from the multi-level linear regression. So here, I know there was a lot of numbers, but I will summarize in this way. So overall, you can see that shift length was not associated with collaboration, but over time, regardless of which indicator of overtime we used, the overtime was significantly associated with collaboration, especially the nurse-nurse collaboration. So for example, if you look at overtime we measured in hours, you can see 1 hour increase in overtime was associated with 0.17 decrease in the collaboration, nurse-nurse collaboration score. Yes, you may notice, well, it's just a 0.17 deduction in the nurse-nurse collaboration score. But I have to tell you, actually, this 0.17 deduction score is about 0.5 standard deviation or half of the standard deviation of the nurse-nurse collaboration measurement. And in other words, this means if a unit, the nurse-nurse collaboration score deduct from the mean by 0.17, which means their rank will drop from 50 percentile to about 30 percentile, which means a 20 percentile drop. And we believe it's a quite, you know, significant or substantial decrease in their ranking of collaboration. So now I will hand over to Dr. Witkowski-Stinfel for the rest of our presentations, and I will be available for any questions at the end of our presentation. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Dr. Ma. So a quick summary of the findings that Dr. Ma just went over. And again, we know that there are a lot of numbers in the tables, and we're happy to go back to them if there are questions at the end. But in summary, we found that what we have learned from previous literature and what we've heard anecdotally, that in this sample, we found that the 12-hour shift is still dominant and that shift overruns are common. And we found that it wasn't shift length, but it was overtime that was significantly associated with collaboration, such that increases in overtime were associated with a decrease in collaboration and a statistically significant, and we think clinically meaningful, decrease in collaboration. So when we think about our next steps in this line of research, we've certainly thought, of course, the next step would be to link these findings to patient outcomes and a number and range of different kinds of patient outcomes to see how that kind of next step would be from the overtime to the impaired collaboration and then what kind of impact that has on patients. We also considered next steps to include an expansion to more hospitals and settings because we were using data from only from hospitals participating in the NDNQI program. So that's a select group of hospitals and certain, you know, only certain numbers of medical, surgical, and critical care units. And there are obviously many, many more units within hospitals and beyond, because we know that collaboration is not exclusive to hospital nurses, but it is across all care settings. So those are some of our thoughts for where we want to take this research next. So when we think about these findings in context with other research and other ways that we could improve care, we wanted to first talk about some strategies that can be used by frontline nursing staff. So first, if you're lucky enough to be a staff nurse that is able to have some say in either self-scheduling or giving some preference for schedule, we would certainly encourage frontline staff to limit the number of consecutive shifts that they work and be mindful of the amount of voluntary overtime that they participate in. If the frontline staff is going to be rotating shifts, there is some evidence that suggests that rotating in a forward pattern is preferential than rotating backwards. So that means that you would rotate from day shift to evening shift to night shift instead of going the other way around. So that is a little bit more adaptive for our bodies. Next, getting adequate rest before and between shifts is highly recommended. And for most adults, that's about 7 to 8 hours of sleep per night. And if going into night shift, having a nap before night shift is also recommended to help get the recommended amount of sleep and to becoming onto the shift as rested as possible. So once we get to the shift, it's important for caffeine to be used strategically. And what I mean by that is that we know that caffeine is a stimulant. It affects our body very quickly, so it reaches peak levels in the blood within 30 to 60 minutes. But it has a pretty long half-life of 4 to 6 hours, so that means that it remains in your body for quite a while. And because caffeine is consumed daily, your body builds up a tolerance to it and it becomes less effective as a stimulant. So it shouldn't be something that's used throughout the entire shift or potentially every day, but should be used really to supplement alertness at the beginning of a shift and going into the shift. So the next strategy is really most helpful for nurses working night shift, but the second half is also helpful for day shift nurses because we know that blue light is the most stimulating and really entrains our body to stay awake. Wearing a blue light blocking sunglasses on the way home from work and reducing exposure to light is really important. And then using an app on your phone or tablet can be really helpful. It also reduces the blue light that we see on electronics. And there are free apps available that will do this and put it, it's almost like a little mask put on your phone. And I think that even some phones now have this feature built in automatically. It's a setting that can be turned on. But that really helps limit some of the really stimulating light that we're getting from all kinds of electronic devices all the time. And of course, for night shift as well, it's important to avoid caffeine and nicotine and alcohol before trying to go to bed. So once you've made it through your shift and you're back at home, it's important to use strategies that promote a healthy sleep environment. And the healthy sleep environment should be a place that's quiet. So using a white noise machine or earplugs or some other way to maintain a quiet atmosphere that's dark. And again, for day shift, it's not as relevant, but for night shift, using an eye mask or blackout shades to make sure that the room is dark. The room should be cool between 68 and 72 degrees. And again, no electronics should be in the sleep environment. And it's important to try and keep these types of behaviors and rituals, these sleep rituals, the same as possible, so that it's a routine just about every night, even if there isn't work going on in the day. And then lastly, if a frontline staff member is looking for a new position or perhaps is a new graduate looking for their first job, seeking a supportive work environment that allows the staff members to take breaks, that limits overtime and excessive consecutive shifts, that has adequate staffing, are all features that, if possible, a staff member should look for when trying to find a new position. And I totally recognize that all of these things are the ideal situation, and it may not always be the case where you can have perfect sleep environment or that you can always pick out your shift. But these are just some strategies to try and think about as kind of goals that will help mitigate some of the effects and the effects of shift work against our natural circadian rhythm. So in addition to some strategies for frontline staff, we thought about some strategies for nurse managers who are on the position of making sure that they have adequately staffed units and that their staff members are as healthy and fit as possible to provide the best care. And so similarly as what we suggested for frontline staff, we would also suggest that managers are aware and monitoring the schedules of their staff members for excessive numbers of shifts, flipping between days and nights too quickly, not having enough time off in between shifts, so that there's some oversight and it's a two-way street between both the staff member and the manager to make sure that nobody's going totally off the walls and has super, super crazy schedule. The next suggestion is to have managers use technology solutions to help them manage their schedules and staffing. So not to necessarily be using a paper and pen and trying to figure out staffing, because there are lots of tools. And I'm sure Courtney can tell us more about that in the question and answer section if people have more questions about what some of these solutions are that are available. But this can really help take off some of that burden from managers. If there's some automated functioning built in to flag when there are some potentially problematic schedules going on. Managers can also help to create a culture of safety where staff feel like they can safely say no to overtime if they feel like they're too tired or if they work too many days in a row. That they really have the ability and management can hear them say, you know, I can't come in for this additional shift, or I can't come in and do overtime. I'm just not, you know, feeling able to be able to do that. Uh, providing professional development on sleep hygiene, on managing shift work. If there's questions about staff having shift work sleep disorder, having appropriate referrals to occupational medicine or sleep medicine consultants, if there's concerns about this, these are all activities that can be provided and facilitated by managers. And we know that most nursing students don't have any content of this in their pre-licensure programs. So having some professional development on the job would be really helpful. And since our study focused on the relationship between nurse-nurse and nurse-physician collaboration, it would be suggested to partner with physicians to educate staff collectively on effective collaboration and how to work together, as well as creating opportunities for continuing education across disciplines on how to be successful in collaboration, since we know that it's not just about nurses and physicians, but there are so many other members of the care team that need to come together and work together to provide the most safe patient care. So those are some of our suggested strategies for managers. And we have a couple of references and are very excited to hear from the audience and answer any questions that may have popped into your brains as you've been watching this webinar. And we would really thank you for attending and for your attention.
Wonderful. Thank you, Amy, Sundrin, and Courtney for that fantastic presentation. We will now begin today's question and answer session. Please submit any questions you have by typing them into your control panel in the space labeled Enter a Question for Staff and clicking Send. We will try to get through as many questions as we have time for. A ton of great questions have been flowing in, so I'm going to start with the first one. And Amy and Sundrin, maybe you can address this. The audience member wants to know what surprised you about your study's findings.
Sure, yes. The great part about research and what makes us so excited, I think, sometimes is that final unveiling of the results. And we may have been thinking one thing, and then the results tell us something different. And then that opens up a whole new line of questions to explore and to try and answer. And I think one area that I was surprised at was that we didn't see a relationship between the actual shift length and collaboration. And I have some thoughts about that. And one might be that there were so many nurses working the 12-hour shifts that we didn't have a whole lot of variation within the shift patterns to see the shift length come out as a significant indicator, because we've seen in previous research that the 12-hour shift compared to shorter shifts, like 8-hour shifts, has been significantly associated with other patient outcomes and other nurse outcomes. So that was one of the surprise findings for me.
Yeah, and I think, you know, related to what Dr. Wickoff-Stiefel just mentioned, is the other part is, you know, it's really about overtime. And we also saw like why, you know, it's really the shift length, but overtime. And when we look back, how we measure it, as well as, you know, from some our daily life experience or observation, I think it's really, you know, first we measure as not, especially when we calculate the overtime in hours, it's really based on the nurse's report of what's the length of shift originally scheduled for you. And then what's the, you know, shift length you actually worked, and we, you know, check the differences. So I think it's really, you know, it seems like nurses coming in, they might kind of have an idea, you know, that's my shift length, I will work these certain hours, even 11, 12 hours, I know it, so I kind of prepared myself. But then approaching the end, you know, now I have to extend my hours, and I might not thought about it, or might have other things scheduled, or I'm already thought about it also mentally, you know. So I think this part is, you know, the overtime influence. It's really We think it's a very great finding from our study, and especially given, we think, yes, it's great if we can reduce long shifts for nurses, but maybe, you know, given the overall situation, it may be harder or it may take time to really eventually achieve this goal. But at least, you know, the relationship between overtime and collaboration give us some idea what we can start to improve the collaboration from overtime, what we can do, you know, to do a better job of scheduling instead of by the end of shift, some kind of, you know, unexpected or not really prepared overtime for the nurses. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing. The next question from our audience member is, did you find any untoward outcomes related to nurses working four or more 12-hour shifts in a row?
No, that's a great question. And actually, you know, we really want, but unfortunately, give the current research design and the data we have access to, we were not really able to, have so much detail. And but I think, you know, thank you for this question. And, you know, we do kind of thought about, and maybe we should talk with either, you know, our the hospitals here or somewhere to kind of do a more detailed follow up or tracking the nurse shift and see how all this will change or influence the collaboration or other things. Hope I answered your question, and thank you.
Perfect. Thank you so much. The next audience member wants to know, are shift lengths related to generational preferences?
That's a good question. So I'm thinking off the top of my head and some of the previous work that I've done, and I actually just completed a study doing a qualitative study interviewing nurses, aging nurses. And so these were nurses who were at least 50 or older and were still working in direct care at the bedside. And at least in that sample, we had primarily the nurses were still working 12-hour shifts. So that's one indicator that it may not necessarily be totally generational, because those nurses are of a different generation. Obviously, if they're 50 and have been working for 30 years, then new nurses coming out. And I think that it would be a little bit hard to answer from some of our previous research, because if the 12-hour shifts were something that were generational, we would probably lose a lot of the older nurses out of the bedside, because so many hospitals only offer 12-hour shifts, or they may only have been only grandfather in so many people who are working 8-hour shifts. So it's a great question, and I think it's a little bit difficult to answer from what I know about the topic. But again, it's a really great question and great to think about, because our bodies do react differently to sleep loss and rotating shifts as we age. So it's a great question.
Great, thank you. Those are really great points. So now I'll direct the next question to Courtney. And an audience member says that they have an initiative to reduce overtime in their hospital. What are some ways that they can be successful in doing this?
Thank you. Some of the ways that you can do that to reduce the overtime would be, you know, using technology and leveraging that. And if you don't have a technology solution to help you do that, you know, reach out and start looking for those solutions that will help you to align your schedules and look at your workload demands on your nursing staff, on your clinical staff, anything that is increasing that demand for care from the patients that's impacting your clinical teams, to ensure your right staffing and to prevent some unnecessary overtime. Being able to use technology to establish equitable workloads and balanced assignments to help nurses get out of there on time so that they can have a balanced work life and also have an increased engagement and satisfaction for the culture of the unit that they're working on. When an employee is approaching overtime, look for something that will provide you notifications to alert you to make proactive schedule adjustments to help prevent that overtime in real time and as quickly as possible. And empowering your nurses with a self-scheduling or a mobile capability tool to give them greater accountability for their schedules and their time, greater functionality to do things in the moment, and responsibility overall with managing their time and their schedules and how their workday goes.
Great, those are awesome examples and points. The next question I have from the audience is, I'll direct it to Amy or Senjin, and they ask, did you find any other factors that may influence nurse shift and or collaboration in your research?
I have do some more research related to collaboration, so I can, jump in first and talk about that. From this study and my previous research, and I think, for sure, the nurse staffing is definitely a big one, right? If you are understaffed, it's really, became a big barrier for nurses to collaborate together well, because part of the collaboration is, when other people really need a help, were you able to do that, right? And also it's, sometimes good communication, where you have the time to do a good communication. That's all part of collaboration. So definitely comes to one thing is the staffing. And also, we have noticed actually the collaboration varied by unit type. So here I only can tell yes, this variation by unit type, and I think we also need to further to look down what specific factors make these units of different type different. So influence the collaboration. It's more at the unit cultural climate, or also, maybe some individual contributions, like maybe the characteristics of the nurses or the physicians or other providers slightly different cross unit type, right? And a couple years ago, I also published a paper to look at, the unit managers, their ability, whether they are, really supportive, a great manager, their levels of management, also have a significant impact on the unit collaborations. Currently I'm, working on a project and almost approaching the end. I also want to look at if, unit utilization of internationally educated nurses play a role, in it, or what kind of role, because they have the, different voices about utilization of internationally educated nurses. We will see, what we will find. So I think I just, mentioned a few of them. And I will stop here and let Dr. Witkowski-Stimpel to see if she has some thoughts.
Yeah, so I think the only thing that I would add, I certainly think there could be other factors in play, but that we did do our best in our models to account for both hospital and unit level factors, as were mentioned earlier. So we looked and controlled for the type of ownership, the bed size, teaching status, magnet status, and type and staffing and nurse education. So despite putting all of those other factors into our models, that overtime still came out as a significant predictor of collaboration. So those are many of the usual suspects that we tend to think about, and we did account for those in our models.
That's super helpful. Thank you both so much. The next question is, What was involved in the collaboration with the physician? What was felt to be lacking?
I think that's definitely a great question, because if we can know more about it, it will give us more explicit suggestions in terms of improving the interdisciplinary collaboration. So so far it's more about, if I recall, although I don't have the scale in front of me, but if I recall, there are items about asking the general perception of, the teamwork between nurse and physicians, but also another one, if I remember, is about the respect, whether nurses and physicians, especially probably, physicians really, have a good understanding of all the scope of nurse practice and, the value of nursing contributing to healthcare, because nurses are, 24 hours, 7 days in front of patient bed. And for sure, physicians, they also play a big role, but they are not there, all the time. And, this is the respect part. And definitely, another part is the communication. When it comes to the communication, is one thing is whether you are communicate timely with each other, but also is about whether you are using the words, the terms, the phrases each other can understand, because our training background is different. So some, and maybe the way nurses think might slightly different from the physicians, or this is also another thing, from my research experience and other literature have been highlighted it. So we think that will be something definitely need to underscore when it comes to nurse and physician collaboration. And one more point I want to say is, maybe we also should take one step further to think about, even we start to, when about education, because that's really the time, I think, for nurse students and medical students kind of, shapes their view of first about their own healthcare professional, but also shapes maybe, the view of their perception and understanding of other healthcare professionals. And I think there have been literature shows, first, there's a missing of interdisciplinary education together. And a second also shows, this kind of lack of interdisciplinary education programs actually do impact, the collaboration in the future. So I think, that there are some points I would like to highlight it. Maybe it's not complete, but it's just my personal research experience and my understanding of, in this area. Thank you very much. And I really like this question.
Yeah, I think this question kind of goes back to the first question about what surprised us and thinking about, where we could go with next steps. And I think that delving deeper into, using maybe qualitative methods and doing some interviews and delving deeper into what those differences were would be really helpful, because, this is one method to use a large survey of over 20,000 nurses and, come up with these findings, but then to go back and ask more questions in a different method and get more in-depth detailed answers.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I wanted to ask all of the presenters, do you have any final thoughts today before we wrap up?
This is a really great opportunity for us, to share our research really knowing that, our research really kind of reach out to a broad audience, and that's our, best hope, that people in the healthcare field can benefit from our research to make some change. And that's, you know, why we are being the researcher, being in healthcare. But overall, you know, we think this really a great opportunity and also give us more driven to do more, better, rigorous research to, in the future.
Yeah, and I would say in closing that I think, you know, this research highlights opportunities for us all, whether frontline staff or the manager, to seek change within an organization, to use resources such as the ones that Courtney spoke about, so that these are modifiable conditions. We can change these factors, you know, perhaps more incrementally than in one fell swoop, but that we can make these improvements, which, you know, ultimately will hopefully benefit the patients and the families, you know, under our care. So that's kind of our, the benefit of this is that we know that we can make positive changes, and we hope to do that going forward.
Great. Well, that is all we have time for today. I want to thank Dr. Amy Witkowski-Stimpfel, Dr. Chenjuan Ma, and Courtney Green for sharing their insights, and Kronos for sponsoring today's program. Enjoy the rest of your day, and we look forward to having you join us for future webinars.